Aloha everybody, this is Christopher with AG Productions, and welcome to another video. We're going to continue with our assembly tips video from the High Elf Chariot here. And as you can see, I am finished assembling my chariot. And I know what you're thinking, that really doesn't look quite like it did on the box art. And you know what? That's why they print contents may vary on the boxes nowadays. You know, it doesn't always come out looking like it does on the box, but sometimes it does. This is one of those times where, well, the contents varied a little bit and it didn't quite end up that, you know, that pristine look that you get. Just kidding. Anyway. Many, in fact, most of my miniatures I do not fully assemble prior to painting. Why? Well, to give you an example, let me just pick the easiest one here. Okay. This chariot here, you can see, has this really nice rune or glyph right here. Okay? The wheel goes on this axle. If I take the wheel and I put it on the axle, that rune or glyph is going to be very difficult to reach with the brush, not to mention the stuff that's around it, so the actual chariot itself, these gems and things like that. The inside of the wheel will be difficult to reach with a brush, with any sort of accuracy, all right? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave the wheel off until I paint this area. Once that area is painted, and once the inside of the wheel is painted, then I'll attach it. And now I can access the outside of the wheel. I don't have to worry about this area anymore, and we're good to go. So anything that I can see with my eyes, but that I cannot access with a brush with ease, I simply don't assemble. All right? So nice, quick, easy little tip. And what I might do, you'll see it as we get into this whole watch me work thing. You'll see me assembling as I go. I don't necessarily paint up this piece entirely, and then paint this piece entirely, and then put them together. What I'll probably end up doing is painting this area here. Once that's done, I'll paint the back of the wheel, and then I'll just slap the two together, and while the glue's drying, I might move up here and paint the front of the chariot or the base or whatever. All right, but you don't have to wait until you get all the pieces done to get the assembly done. Okay, so that's one of the things that that is a fun little assembly tip. Next on the list. All right, let me scrape all this stuff out of the way here. We've got the lions. Now, you may remember the lions. Hopefully, yeah, it should be uploaded by now. You've seen the lions in the previous video. If you haven't, I will put the link for the previous video in the video description down there. You remember how I closed up this little lion right there? That works really, really well unless you have a texture change. What do I mean? Well, going from the right hip to the left hip, or vice versa, on this lion, the texture is exactly the same. You're dealing with lion fur, or in this instance, because GW was too cheap to do it, a flat surface. But if you're going from, for instance, where this gap is, the mane of a lion, to a piece of armor, you can't do this, because it just doesn't work. You've got to have a nice smooth transition for this type of bond to function well. So what we do instead, in this area, what I'm going to do is I'm going to extend the texture. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to take some green stuff. Now, I'm not going to show you how to do this right now. It's kind of a pain in the butt, and I really don't want to go through it. If you want to see how it's done, pick up, I believe it's Disc 2 of Masterpiece Miniatures. Yeah, I go through how to deal with green stuff on both smooth and textured surfaces. It's a really, really good demo. But if you, what I'm going to do is I'm going to come in and I'm going to add some green stuff around this armor plate. All right, and it's going to fill in this gap. And then what I'm going to do is re-sculpt some hair, and some of that hair is probably going to fall on top of this armor plate. So it's going to look like that mane is flowing over the armor. And all it's going to do, the only reason I'm doing it, is to cover this gap. But at the same time, we have to also take into consideration that in the real life world, or in a real situation, assuming you could get a piece of armor onto a lion, the odds are pretty good some stray hairs from his mane would end up flowing over these pieces of armor. All right, the same thing happens here. wherein you're transferring from one area of hair to another area of hair. This technique right here works really great for smooth surfaces. It doesn't work quite as well for textured surfaces. So what I'm going to do is add in some green stuff in this area and some green stuff in this area. Probably do the same thing as going around the entire face and just sort of sculpt out this area. I mean, you can see a clear delineation from the front of the lion's head right here. You can see that line, and we don't want to be able to see it. But all it takes is a little bit of green stuff resculpted in the appropriate manner to match the texture, or at least give you a reasonable facsimile of the texture, and you'll never be able to tell that this was two separate pieces. Again, I'm not going to do that on camera for you guys, because it's a long, tedious process, or it can be, depending on how in-depth you want to go. But I want you to understand that if you want your miniatures to look really outstanding, I mean, you know, you've always got the option. Take them out of the box, cut them up, put them together, and throw them on a gaming table. I'm not a gamer. I am an artist. Well, I say that. I'm a painter. Let's leave it at that. I'm not necessarily an artist either. I'm too logical to be an artist. I don't like taking risks, and I don't, you know, hear colors and all kinds of weird stuff. But coming at this with the idea that I want this to be a display piece, I need to fix all of these little things before I get to painting. Because if I don't, they're going to be glaring mistakes or glaringly obvious issues once the painting is done. Okay? So we need to fix that. Last but not least, on the pro tip counter here, let me zoom out. Alright, you see all this crap right here, these little shavings and junk, and then you can kind of zoom over here, see all that crap laying over there by my lamps, and then that giant pile of sprues over there, and all that junk. Okay, first of all, that pile, it's got to go in the garbage. Second of all of this junk all over the desk, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that pile right there, all my parts, I'm going to take it off my desk, put it on another desk, the one that's behind me. And then I'm going to take a vacuum cleaner, and I'm going to vacuum this whole freaking desk off, all right? And all that's going to do is it's going to keep these little squigglies and scrimpy things that flaked off the model when I was cleaning it, it's going to keep that from getting into my paint and keep it from getting into my green stuff when I start working on green stuffing out the lion's manes, okay? You don't want this junk in your paint, and you certainly don't want it in your gap-filling equipment either. It's really, really bad if it gets into your paint, though, because then you're actually adding texture to the miniature as you go. And, I mean, you know, if this stuff starts flying around, you happen to hit the table too hard, some of this bounces, you get it into a skin tone or something like that, all of a sudden your guy's got what looks like a piece of glass sticking out of his face. It's just like a hard piece of sprue that's colored with flesh tone. It just gets nasty. So when you're done cleaning your miniatures, by all means, clean your desk off. And the only reason is because, simply put, you don't want any foreign objects getting into your clean material, be it paint, be it green stuff, be it glue. When I go to assemble my miniatures, if some of this material here, if some of that crap gets between one piece of a model and another, your bond with your glue is not going to be as strong. So make sure after you do all of your cutting to get your miniatures ready to be assembled, you take those, you put them somewhere else, and you clean off your desk, okay? Real simplistic. A lot of people don't think about it, but I guarantee you it's going to help you avoid what could potentially turn into a major disaster. Anyway, that's all I've got for you guys today as far as the assembly process goes. What I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and finish this thing up. Unless there is something major and glaring that sticks out at me, I think we're done with the assembly. I will show you guys a picture of this guy or a short video of this guy right before I go to prime him. That way you can see the fully assembled, or at least as assembled as it's gonna get, miniature before it gets primed. And then we're gonna start on the painting process. But I hope that you've enjoyed this little foray into the assembly of plastic miniatures. I know there wasn't a whole lot of actual assembly that was done, as you can tell. But hopefully you've learned a little bit. Hopefully you've picked up a few quick little tips and tricks that you can use to help your painting technique grow and become better. And maybe it's inspired you to pick up a miniature and put some paint on it. I don't know. Anyway, if you haven't clicked the subscribe button, make sure to do that, because we're going to have a lot of videos coming out over the next few weeks and months, and I think you're going to be excited to see those. Be sure to click the like button, as well as, if you want to, feel free to leave a comment down in the comment section down below. That's all I've got for you guys today, so thank you very much for watching. God bless you all. Have a fantastic rest of the day, and I will see you all in the next video.